You might remember this soldering circuit board holder thing from the most recent mailbag. Well, obviously, I need to test it and see if I like it, see how it's going to work for me. And the best way to do that is with a kit build. Or, in this case, I'm going to do two quick kit builds. These are both cheap metal detector kits that I got out of other previous mailbags. Probably almost a year ago, some of these. This one comes with a case and some battery terminals and an actual instruction pamphlet. Well, not really instructions, it's just Chinese information and the schematic. This other one doesn't come with a case or battery connections or schematic, but I went on it's an EQ kit, this one. Anyway, I went on their website and I found this schematic for that one. And wouldn't you know it, the two schematics are almost identical. There's the same 222 capacitor and inductor in the base side of the NPN transistor. There's the same inductor and 222 capacitor in the collector side. There's a slightly different value of variable resistor in the emitter, followed by a PNP transistor. This one's got 2K, this one's got 2.2K, 104 capacitor, another PNP transistor, drawn slightly differently. This one has an LED in parallel with speaker output. This one doesn't. That's the only real difference. It's essentially the same circuit. And so the metal detector circuit itself, where's that pointy stick here? So the metal detection actually happens there. The rest of this is just switching and amplifying the output. This is the actual metal detection. And the layout of that circuit is essentially a Colpitts oscillator. Let me show you. So here's the Wikipedia article on oscillators in general, and a couple of common inductor capacitor oscillators, the Hartley and the Colpitts. Similar, but slightly different in configuration. And the oscillator that we have for a metal detector is most similar to the Colpitts. It doesn't have this choke in series with the power source. But basically, the important part is the capacitor and inductor in series. I realize that the Hartley has two inductors, but the Colpitts has a single one. However, our circuit has two inductors. So why am I thinking it's the Colpitts? Let's go back to the board for a second here. So this L2 is the inductor in parallel with the capacitor that you see in the Colpitts oscillator circuit. This one is sort of forms a transformer with L2 rather than being part of the oscillator. So it is affected by it, but there's feedback coming to the base side, which affects how it oscillates and increases or decreases the frequency or the amplitude. I'm actually not sure, but what I do know is because these two inductors are sort of wound around each other, L1 is a much smaller inductor than L2. On both of these boards, one of the inductors is both sides of the board, except for one single wrap, one single loop. And that single loop is the one that's in the base side. So it's essentially acting as a transformer with sort of an air gap between them. Now then, what upsets the oscillation or modifies it so that you can detect that there's metal is just the fact that you're bringing a chunk of metal into the magnetic field of these two inductors, of the transformer essentially, and that will change the overall inductive characteristics and change the way the oscillator happens, and that will change the frequency of it. That's how most of these cheap metal detectors work. The professional ones you pay hundreds of dollars for work in a slightly different way. They have two different oscillators running at the same frequency, and when the chunk of metal interferes with the path between those two oscillators, one of them goes slightly off frequency and causes a beat frequency, which is what you hear in your headphones. But that's not this one. This one's different. This one just, the inductance changes because of the presence of a chunk of metal. That's how I understand the circuit anyway. But that's enough theory. And I'm not going to do a lot of yakking while I'm building these, unless I come across something really bizarre. I'm just going to throw them both together because this isn't really about the kits. Although I'm going to play with them at the end, obviously, to see if either of them work differently. They should work almost the same. Like I said, the component values are very slightly different. The only real difference is the shape and size of the coil. And I guess that this one, you get to be a little bit more hands-off so that your hand isn't causing any changes in inductance. So the biggest test for the board holding, I think, is going to be this Starship Enterprise-shaped board. Do I want to clamp it in that way? Or do I want to clamp it in this way? No, I think the other way is probably going to hold it better. Slide that in a little bit so I got some spring tension up there. Clamp that down. Now then, so this is the solder side of the board, so I'm going to want it this way. Solder, whatever. I know it offends some people when I say it the way that I've been saying it for the past 50 years, but I don't care. Different regions have different pronunciations. Okay, so that's, I guess, to hold it rigidly, if I crank those both down, that's nice and rigid. And then when I loosen that up to spin them over. Okay. Oh, so the other thing that I'm going to do tonight, a lot of people have commented on my soldering tips. I've been using these two mostly since I got this this Heiko iron. I've been using this little needlepoint one when I'm doing surface mount and really fine stuff. And I've been using this sort of skewed, I don't know, what do you call those? Anyway, using that one when I'm doing through hole and just joining wires and stuff. I went digging through my collection of tips and I found this one, which is a small chisel point, which is about, yeah, it's a little bit narrower than that one and obviously wider than this one. But being a, I don't know, we'll try it out. What the hell, I'm experimenting here. This one, when I've got a large pad to go on to, I can get in there pretty well. But this one, I think I'll be able to sort of get onto the pad and onto the lead fairly well. I don't know. We'll find out. Oh, yeah. And the beer du jour is one of my old favorites, Fort Garry Dark Ale, an English mild ale. They refer to it as a nut brown ale sometimes. It's just a nice relaxing beer. And like I said, it's one of the first smaller breweries that popped up on the scene around here, probably 10 plus years ago, and I've been enjoying it for a very long time, including tonight. So I'll just get started here, figuring out what the components are. That looks like about a 2K resistor. According to this, that should be R2. R2 is right there, and it doesn't say, in fact, say 2K. I'm just going to toss all the resistors in, measuring them because I don't trust my colorblind ancient eyes. For 70 ohms, that's going to be the one that's in series with the LED R3. Okay. If I hold this way up, I mean, I'm soldering up there. How does that look? Maybe that's a little bit better, because then I can actually read the silk screen. Okay. One final resistor, which should be in the couple hundred K range. Yeah, that's close enough to 200K, which is what R1 is. Tighten up these so that it doesn't move around while I'm doing this, and clean my tip and get in there. I'm liking this tip so far. For years in the past, I've always just gone with whatever happens to be on the iron and not concerned myself with it too much. But I don't mind that. I'm still not going to say that that's the only tip I'll ever use, but that's pretty good. Let's put in some capacitors next. 222, 104, 104. These are a super simple little kit. It wasn't really 222. It wasn't really my intention to challenge myself in the electronic theory department too badly. I just wanted to get a feel for working with this guy here. Are those all? Oh, that one's not quite in place. I didn't even tighten that up. Actually, that's got not bad resistance on it. I've got them sort of set in a medium position. Okay, what else should I put on there next? I'll put the electrolytic in, I guess. Who are you? You are 100 microfarad, 16 volts. That goes there. Positive side goes that away. What else can I put in reasonably? Put the LED in. What is that? Buzzer? Oh. The hell? I got a hair in there. Is that an actual hair or is that just plastic hair? Whatever. So buzzer. Positive says, okay, it's polarized, it's marked. We'll do that. That's enough. Ooh, that's a big... Ah, that's why. That's right on the ground plane. Who was it was mentioning that they always have trouble with that too because the ground plane sucks the heat away? Probably everybody, but somebody was mentioning it recently. Julian Islet, maybe? Okay. Should I put the transistors in now? Yeah, why not? There's two of one kind and one of the other. Nine oh one two, nine oh one two, and 9018 is our NPN. And the silk screen shows them going that way. I think I'm going to solder those in one at a time, just so they don't get in each other's way. You can't see it off camera, but I am cleaning my tip. Each time I set my iron down, after each time I pick it up after I've set it down. And even right there in between joins. You probably noticed when I pulled my soldering station in that I'm using the old-fashioned wet sponge technique for cleaning. And I know people are going to complain because they will say that it shocks your tips and damages them, and that's probably true. But again, it's the old school method that I've been using for decades. And I haven't really noticed that kind of damage to any significant amount anyway. So I'm just going to keep doing what I've always done. I do have one of the metal scrubby pad things that I do use occasionally, but it's just not in a convenient location at the moment. How do those look for wonkiness? Not bad. So all of these soldering holders that I've been playing with over the last many months, trying to find if there's an optimum solution, one of the benefits of them that I've found over and over again is they all lift the board up off the bench and get it closer to my aging eyes. which alone is a win. Okay, those are sitting relatively straight. I'm liking being able to flip this guy back and forth. Variable resistor, 101, 100 ohms. What? 101, yeah. Really? It is, in fact. So, the schematic's lying to us, which means it's even more similar to the circuit on the other one. Matter of fact, I think the other one did say 100 ohms on it, so they're closer to being identical. Plug that in. Plug in this switch here. I think I'm going to have to hold it with a little bit of blue shtick. Now then, that potentiometer on this ground pin over here is going to be a little bit of a trick just because there's so much metal and so much ground plane, but that worked pretty well. Okay. And now the other switch, or the actual switch, I guess, the on-off switch, which is just electrically a single pole switch, an on-off switch, but in reality it's a double pole, double throw, just because they're cheap and common. Power input, and I think we've run out of components. And again, I'll just and there we go. It looks like a completed board. Do we have any obvious short circuits or cold solder joints? Doesn't look like it. No, my boot tack off. Remove after washing. I'm not going to wash it. Okay. Shall we see if this one works, or should we build the other one first? No, we'll see if this one works. The schematic says 3 to 5 volts. And the other one runs on 3 volts, by witness of the fact that it uses two AA batteries. So, I'll set my Wii power supply here down to 3 volts. Connect up the power and see what happens. Okay, it makes noise. Tone changes a little bit. But holy hell, that's annoying. Okay, so it does something, but that wasn't really the point of the exercise. The point of the exercise was to play with this. Now, but just since I'm doing metal detectors, I'm going to put the other one together quickly here, too. Not sure how much of the actual building I'm going to leave in the video, because, I don't know, the soldering, how interesting is that? I probably yammered on a little bit while I was doing it, but I'm not sure how interesting that is. We'll find out. Okay, so that obviously holds in there nice and tight too, because it's square, and why wouldn't it? Yeah, so I'll just slam that guy together, and I'll come back in a bit. What should this one, 220K? This is presenting a bit of an extra challenge, just because of the force the component leads, but it's still working pretty well. Okay, there is the circuit done. Now just a matter of putting these mechanical bits on. And the battery holder, and yeah. So, I guess we'll shove that guy into there. There we go. Which means that one goes there and there. Maybe this goes the other way up. Is it going that way? Possibly. Those two are in the wrong spots. That's positive, which is that one. Have to go old school with this, I guess. Not super beautiful, but I've seen an awful lot worse on sale in stores. Okay, that guy ought to mount somehow into there. So how do I adjust it then? Is that just kind of jams in there? Okay, sure it does. Is there pillars or something though? Hold it in place, not really. And I gotta bend those down. Is that how it fits, really? What holds that in place? Okay, fine. Be like that. fourth screw. Sure there was. There it is. Notice how bravely I'm not even testing the thing. Because that's not really the point of the exercise tonight. I mean, it'd be cool if it actually worked. But it's not going to work any better than the other one. Fairly confident on that score. Noise. Yeah. Okay. So it does. It does change a little bit when metal moves close to it. Interesting that it's in the case. Annoying that you can't adjust it from whatever. That's not what tonight's about. Tonight is about this thing. And it held both of those boards very nicely, actually. Solidly, I didn't have any problems. I just adjusted these to not to super firm tension, not to completely loose and floppy, just somewhere in between. And it held it nicely when I was soldering it. It didn't push it out of the way. When I flipped it over and I was pushing the components in, it didn't cause me problems. I'm going to call that a win. Also, this is my second project with my brand new MG Chemicals Made in the USA solder. Actual 6040. Really digging that. This new tip. I guess I can turn it off now. Let me clean that. Okay, this new tip, different shape, I'm digging that too. I see why people recommend that chisel shape. That worked out pretty well. Yeah, I'm fairly pleased with how this turned out. This is going to definitely be a permanent addition to my collection of work holding. So since I haven't shown them all together since I got this new one, let's bring in some of the fleet of board holders that I've accumulated, or soldering aids. So there's the original Helping Hands that I've had forever. I think I got that one at Princess Auto. Americans can translate that as Harbor Freight. They're available all over the place online as well. They're cheap. They're ubiquitous. This one I got, which works well for surface mount, not so much for through-hole, especially on dense boards or boards with stuff near the edge. But it works well enough. And who was it that I first saw that one? David Watts, I think, uses one of those fairly frequently. Then I got this little 3D printed one, which is a file off a Thingiverse. Oh, come on. File off a Thingiverse, and just had it printed at the library. And that works well for holding boards securely as well. And then just an elastic band to adjust your tension. That works well. Another one that I've had forever is this Dremel D-Vise, which, let me just grab another small board from over here. That's not a small board. But it works well and holds really securely. Especially if you got to do something mechanical. That's not going to open. But there's, oh no. So it's got soft rubber jaws on it. But underneath that, it's also got grooved jaws, which take the board very nicely and hold it very firmly without having to clamp too hard. So there's that guy. What else? Oh yeah, the one that I made. Hang on. Yeah, this one that I made up here, it's in mid-project right now. It takes up pretty much my entire workbench, which is a bit of a downside of it. But it can hold a bunch of things together at once. And if you're doing, you know, parts that have to come in at odd angles and be held while you're doing things, it works well for that. I think it'll also work well for modeling, actually. This project, yeah, it's taking longer than I thought. I'll get back to that at some point. But all that variety isn't what today's about. Today, this is the star of the show, and I think it's a winner. I'm definitely going to put that one to use quite often. Several people in the mailbag video commented that there were cheaper sources of it locally in their country, which is great. Unfortunately, the Canadian market doesn't have an awful lot of what you call local sellers anymore, especially in the city that I live in. There are some in some of the larger cities, but postage and shipping within Canada is just horrendous. I'd pay more to ship one of these from Toronto or Vancouver to here than I did actually paying for this from China. So there's that. Sorry, local sellers, but you and Canada Post have priced you guys out of the market on a lot of stuff. I'll still try and buy locally when I can, like for instance that solder. Yay. But you know how it goes. Anyway, verdict. I like it. I'm keeping it. Thanks for watching. I will talk to you later.